Good morning, everybody.
So after this long introduction, I hope to have convinced you. Dai ragazzi. So after this long introduction, I hope to have convinced you that it's interesting to try to understand the physics of systems having many local minima in the free energy or energy landscape. This is due to frustration and to disorder that induce frustration. And so the first thing that we are going to do now is to restrict our attention to mean field model, in particular to fully connected models, and try to define properly what is a state. So let me say one minimum of this typical drawing I do, okay? So I want to understand how can I define these points, which are, let me say, the minima of the free energy in some space of, say, magnetizations or parameters, mean field parameters that describe the system. And I want to understand how can I define and how can I count these points, okay? And in turn, then I will try to understand what is the physics of system, of complex system. By complex system, I mean a system having many states, okay? There is already one case that you know very well because Matteo spent the first two lectures on this model. We already know one system having two minima, which is the Kurivais model for temporal smaller than the critical temperature, where you do have, if you plot the free energy as a function of the global magnetization, you do have something like this, okay? So you have two local minima. So the one could say, okay, since we know how to define this point in the Kurivais model, can we generalize this tool to a situation where I have a model with many, many minima in the free energy function? And the problem is that in a Kurivais model, we know how to select one of these two states by just applying an external field. So essentially, we put an external field and we choose one of the states. So the first problem we have that in general, in a complex model like this, we don't know what is the direction of this local minima. So we don't know the field I should put in order to select that direction. Okay, so in the Kurivais model, everything is very simple. Here is much more complicated. And moreover, even in the Kurivais model, you have to be careful, and it depends how you do the computation, because if you just apply an external magnetic field, you should have seen in Matteo's lecture that actually, if you apply a magnetic field and you compute the free energy in a magnetic field, and then you do the Legendre transform to obtain the free energy as a function of the magnetization, you don't get this. You get the convex envelope of this free energy. Actually, you get this, okay? Why? Well, just to remind you, if you compute the free energy in presence of an external field that I call B, just to keep the same notation of Francesco Zamponi notes, so you can then look there the computation. So you compute the free energy as the sum over all the spins of exponential minus beta h of the spins plus this term beta sum over I s I b I. So you see what I did. I apply an external field. So this is the original Hamiltonian. I put on top of the Hamiltonian, which eventually already contains a field. I don't care about what is in the Hamiltonian, but I put on top of this a new field I call B, BI, in order to select one state. In the case of the Q-device model, I can just put a uniform field because the direction of the minima is along all spins aligned, so the fields can be the same. And by doing this summation, I'm computing a free energy in presence of a field, and I make this dependency explicit. Obviously, the free energy also depends on the inverse temporal beta, but I don't put the explicit dependence on beta. And from this expression, it's easy to obtain that the mean value of the spin in presence of this external field, so this is the mean value of SI when the average is done on this measure here, you can obtain just by taking the derivative of this free energy as a function of BI. You see, if you take the, and there is a factor, maybe I shouldn't put the beta there. Ah, no, yes, there is a beta here. Okay, everything is fine. Okay, so you see that if you want to fix a given magnetization of spin S, you have to choose the right external field B such that the derivative of F with respect to BI is exactly the magnetization that you want to enforce. And this F of B is concave. So concave is means downwards curvature, because if you take the second derivative of F with respect to BI and with respect to BJ, you see, if you take the second derivative, you are computing dMI over dBJ, and this is the susceptibility. The susceptibility is the derivative of the magnetization with respect to the external field. And and in the canonical ensemble, I hope you have seen this, this is equivalent to minus beta, the connected correlation between spin SI and spin SJ. If you have not seen it, it's an exercise for you. You take, so if you have not seen it, you have an exercise, which is in the canonical ensemble, show that the derivative of the mean value of SI with respect to BJ is equal to minus beta SI minus MI SJ minus MJ. Okay? Now, these are a connected correlation which is strictly positive. This matrix is positive defined, and so the second derivative of F, because of this sign, is negative defined. And so F of B is a concave function in the space of the n-dimensional space of fields. This means that now, if you take the Legendre transform, in order to get back an expression of the free energy in terms of magnetization, because we are looking for this free energy as a function of the magnetization in order to locate all the minima of the free energy as a function of the magnetization. So you do the Legendre transform, which amounts to computing, keeping the notation of Zamponi lecture notes, this is defined as minus beta, the maximum over B, of F of B plus the sum over I, BI MI. You see, F of B is concave. Okay, so this is concave. You add a linear term, a concave function plus a linear term is still concave. So you take the maximum, so the maximum is unique, and you compute this free energy gamma as a function of M. However, because of the properties of Legendre transformation, if you Legendre transform a concave function, so a function which has a second derivative which is always of the same sign, in this way, you get a convex function. So a function which always has the second derivative of the same sign, okay? So this function is convex. And it's the one I plot here by the dashed curve, okay? So this means that even in the Kurzweil model, if we try to select states that we know they are, they exist, because by doing this microcanonical computation at fixed magnetization, I got a function with two minima. So the minima are there. But if I do a canonical computation in presence of a field, then I remove the field in order to keep the magnetization, because obviously now these fields are used to fix the magnetization here. What I get is a convex function. So I can fix any magnetization, but the function will be convex. So I don't get the function with two minima, but just the convex envelope, which is this one. Now, in the Kurzweil model, I can still understand something, because I can look for the first point where essentially this becomes flat, and so I can argue that I can still identify the, let me say, m naught and minus m naught position. But this, because it's the Kurzweil model, and everything is very simple. If you try to do in this landscape, essentially the gamma function is providing you no information. Okay? So we have to look for a different route in order to end up with this point. And this is what I call the tap states. I could leave it because... Okay, so let me start explaining you why we should be able to do some kind of computation of those minima. And so let me discuss a little bit more what I mean by states, okay? Because at the moment, states are the minimum of free energy function that we are still unable to compute. So it's not a good definition, the minimum of a function that you are not able to compute. So let's try to have a better definition of states. So a general result from mathematics say that any Gibbs measure in finite dimension, in infinite dimension, is more difficult, but you can always decompose in pure states. What I mean by this, you take a probability measure over n variables, our spins, but it can be of any kind. You can always write as the sum. This is approximated, but in the thermodynamic limit is really equal to a sum over states with a given weight, and this probability distribution P alpha, which is restricted to a state. Just to be concrete, let me give you a more precise definition, then we'll do an example. So, what is the property of this probability distribution within a state? He has a key property that correlation decays. This is called the clustering property. In physics, and in mathematics, what you say is that this probability distribution is almost factorized. So in fully connected models is almost factorizable, okay? And so in some sense, it's easy to approximate. The clustering property essentially says that within a state, all correlation decay very fast. So if you take the average over this distribution, so let me call this is the sum over spins over this distribution within one state alpha, okay? On this measure, on this probability distribution, if you compute any connected correlation function, it decays very fast when the spins are far apart. This infinite dimension where you can very well define pure states. So essentially this means that if you compute the connected correlation function within one state, this goes to zero when the distance between I and J is very large. This is the clustering property. Why this helps you? Because essentially it says that within one state, you don't have a very strong correlation. If you don't have a very strong correlation, this joint probability of n variables can be well approximated. This is a general rule. If you have a joint probability of n variables and these are strongly correlated, there is no way you approximate it. But if they are weakly correlated, eventually if they are independent, and so the probability distribution is a product of single variable probability distribution, this is much, much better, okay? And so this clustering property says variables are weakly correlated. Maybe they are correlated up to a given distance, but no more. Now, if you take this property in a fully connected model, there is no notion of distance. All variables are at a distance one. And indeed, in fully connected models, this property amounts at say that the probability distribution within one state essentially is the factorization over all the sites of single site probability distributions. You have no notion of distance, so if the correlation must decay, they must decay immediately. At distance one, they already must have decay. And so only if the product, only if the measure is a product measure, so it's a factorized measure, this connected correlation is zero. Okay? So in this product measure, any Si Sj is equal to Si Sj. They are factorized. Now, since we are using Ising variables, you can also write these single site marginals in a simple form. So I can rewrite this as the product over I, always from 1 to n, of 1 plus mi alpha si divided by 2. Okay? So you see that essentially what we are saying is that in general we can decompose the joint probability distribution of our variables in this way, and in particular in fully connected models on this factorized probability distribution which depends only on the magnetizations. So in practice what we are saying is that under this hypothesis our joint probability distribution of spins can be well described by a set of numbers which are the weights that enters here and the magnetization that enters in each state. Okay? So these are our definition of states. Okay? So these are our states. So essentially, a state is one set of magnetization that tells us in which direction the probability measure is strongly concentrated. In Q-device, you just have two spots. But in complex systems, you have many spots, and you have to identify all these directions. So in particular, this description exam Q-device, this description, so the probability distribution of Q-device can be well described by two numbers, which is 1/2 if you are at zero external field, otherwise one of the two minima will dominate, and the magnetization Okay, so this is the, in the case of Q-device, where obviously M-naught solves the self-consistency equation that you derive for Q-device. Okay, so now our aim is to try to identify this magnetization. And in a full analogy of what you did in Q-device, when you identify this magnetization by solving a self-consistency equation, we want to derive self-consistency equations for these more complicated variables, because now we are in the presence of disorder, so the disorder will induce states in direction which are uncorrelated and more complicated to identify. So let's try to write a self-consistency equation of this kind, but for the general case. And let me use this. So I'm using this model, which is the usual one, but I just want to rewrite before starting the computation. And you can also add an external field if you like. There is no problem. Okay? Well, this is the Hamiltonian we are using. And now let's try to write the self-consistency equation for this magnetization. So let's do the following. I consider a spin I, and all the spins he's attached to. They can be all, some, in fully connected model, they will be all, okay? And so to each spin J is connected to a coupling J at J, and then eventually there is also an external field here. So the same naive mean field approximation that leads to this equation can be written in the following form. You just consider a factorized measure for these spins. So you say if all these spins have a factorized measure, so the probability of all these spins is a product of mj sj, okay? Then when you write down the equation for mi, what you have? Mi, which is the average value of Si, which is the average value. So you are considering this subsystem, and obviously there is all the rest of the system which produce the correlation between these variables. And so you have to, when you compute the magnetization of this variable, you have to consider the effect of all its neighbors. And the explicit computation provides you hyperbolic tangent of beta, the sum over j, jij, sj, plus beta hi. This is an exact equation, because I'm just rewriting the spin variable in terms of its neighbors. Now, the problem is that these are eventually correlated. But if you take the naive mean field approximation, which means I take all the neighbors completely uncorrelated, you can rewrite this average value. Now, you just have to replace S with M. If you don't believe that this is the right thing to do, you take this, you expand in power Taylor series, you take the average of each term, and then you see that in the average you substitute S with M, and you resum the power series, Taylor series, and you get this expression with M instead of S. And so this is just the hyperbolic tangent of beta sum over J, Jij, Mj, plus beta Hi. Okay? This is exactly the naive mean field equation that you derive for the Q-device model, but now magnetization can be different in any point, okay? So this equation is fine for the Q-device model, and it's fine also for ferromagnetic models where the couplings are different. So you see now the couplings are not all the same, also the external fields. And so this equation, which we call naive mean field equation, are fine for ferromagnetic models. non-frustrated models. Unfortunately, for spin glasses are not. And now I will try to convince you that you need to add one more term here, which is called the Onsager reaction term, in order to get a sensible result. But first, let me try to convince you of where is the problem. The problem is that these spins are not perfectly uncorrelated. Okay? So this factorization is not really exact. Okay? Why? Well, first of all, because they are connected to this spin. Okay? So this is the main source of correlation among these spins. It's true that they are also connected to other spins, but I will try to convince you that the correlation induced by the presence of this spin, when you propagate on this, are zero. Essentially, if you give a value to this spin, they induce some correlation here, and when you take this correlation, you propagate through new couplings which are uncorrelated from this. They are random and different. The net effect is zero. But it's non-zero for the correlation induced by these spins. So this spin induce some weak, very weak correlation in these neighbors. And when then you use these neighbors to obtain back the field in this way on this spin, this correlation are relevant. So we have to do the computation more carefully. And so let's split, let's compute the magnetization of this spin, but splitting the local field that they felt in two terms. One term arriving from I, and one term arriving from the rest of the world, the rest of the spin, including these other guys. Okay? So we can, let me rewrite so more explicitly this system in this way. So this I, these spins are, I call it J, this J, A, J, and now this field here, I call it, let me call it HJ cavity, is defined as the local field felt by J, by sigma J, SJ, when I is not present, okay? This is why I call it cavity, because you do a hole, okay? So essentially, HJ cavity is the field felt by SJ when all this part of the system is absent. Okay? And now we want to solve this very simple system. The problem is that, in principle, we don't have access to H cavity. We have to compute it, because we have access to the magnetization of J in the full system. So the first thing to do is to estimate H cavity. And how to do it? Well, the full field felt by SJ is the sum of H cavity plus the term coming from here. So the magnetization on spin J is equal to the hyperbolic tangent of beta. And here you have two terms, HJ cavity, which is what you get from the rest of the system, plus JIJ SI. Okay, so what you get from here. And actually, since, let's put MI. Okay? Notice that this term is very small. This term is order one, while J is order one over square root of N. Okay? So these are tiny correction. And what we did when we derived the naive mean field equation, essentially is to disregard about this term and say this cavity field is essentially the same in the full system or without this spin. And if you are in a Kurzweil model where J is 1 over N, that approximation is fine. But here J is 1 over square root of N. So it's going to zero much, much slower. Okay? So from this, you can expand. And so this becomes essentially hyperbolic tangent of beta HJ cavity plus you do the first derivative and you get beta 1 minus hyperbolic tangent square of beta H J cavity times jij mi. And this part here, this term, you can rewrite also as, since we are in the, already in the correction, you can substitute to hyperbolic tangent of beta hj cavity, which is this term, you can substitute mj, because these are equal at leading order, so in the correction you can put the leading order. And so this 1 minus mj square, and you recognize that this is nothing but the diagonal element of the susceptibility matrix, okay? So this beta sj sj minus sj sj. This one, and this mj square, okay? So this is the response of spin j when you apply a field on j. Okay, is the local response. So if you perturb a little bit that spin, this how much it responds. Okay? And you see, you are perturbing that spin with mi times j, which is a small quantity. So this is a small perturbation. And so you can understand that hyperbolic tangent of beta at j cavity is equal to mj, which is the magnetization in the full system, minus this term here. So minus beta 1 minus mj square, jij mi. So what we understood is that if we keep the first correction, the cavity magnetization, which is this object, is different from the full magnetization because there is a term coming from the ith spin. And now we can solve this system, which is very easy to solve because we have few variables, we have to sum over all variables. So I leave you this as an exercise. And if you solve this system, and you compute the magnetization of these variables, of this I variable, what you get is mi is equal to hyperbolic tangent of beta hi plus beta, the sum over the neighbors, j, jij, times the cavity magnetization, because you see, you have the cavity magnetization, then you propagate, and I is summing all the contribution coming from the neighbors. But you have to take the cavity magnetization. So here, you have to put this cavity magnetization, okay? Because you are solving really this system, which is linear now, okay? And so you have to put this expression here, mj minus beta 1 minus mj square mjij mi. Okay, so what we got, while these were the Naïmian field equation, now these are called the TAP equation. TAP stands for Towles, Anders, Anderson, Palmer, that derived this equation in 1977. Okay? You see the difference between these because essentially here you have one more term. So if you forget about this term, which is what is called the Onsager reaction term, if you forget about the Onsager reaction term, you have exactly the Naïmian field equation. Now we are adding this one more term, and I will try to convince you that this is relevant for spin glasses, useless for Curie Weiss, okay? So let's erase here. Indeed, let me rewrite it by just putting evidence the first and the second term. So these TAP equations are hyperbolic tangent of beta hi plus beta sum over j, jij, mj, which is the naive mean field approximation terms, minus beta square sum over j of jij square, 1 minus mj square, times mi that you can put outside or whatever you want. Okay? I just rewrite the expression. So we notice two things. That first of all, this looks like a second, or actually, is a third, a second order term in an expansion in beta j. You see this zero order term, beta j, first order term, beta square, j square. Moreover, the importance of this term obviously depends on the variance of the j. If you are in the Q-revised model, where j are of order 1 over n, and j square are of order 1 over n square, since the sum is over all your neighbors, and in a fully connected model, all your neighbors are n, this term is 1 over n, so it's irrelevant, compared to this term, which is order 1, because it's n times 1 over n. So this term is always order 1, because it's the local field. It must be order 1 if we scale correctly the coupling. But this not. Why, in a spin glass case, okay, I forget to tell you that the fully connected version of the spin glass model is called Sherrington-Kilpatrick model. It's worth acknowledging that Sherrington-Kilpatrick solved it first. So in the Sherrington-Kilpatrick model, in the fully connected spin glass model, you have j square, which are of order 1 over n. And so this term, which is n times 1 over n, is of order 1. So you cannot disregard it. Okay? And so in this way, we see that we have to strongly modify the mean field equation in order to correctly describe the system. And this is due because, you see, there is a j square. So what's happening is what I was saying to you before. I is inducing some correlation among these spins via the coupling j. And that correlation is propagated back via the coupling j. And so what you get at the end is j square, sum over the neighbor. So if the couplings are very weak, 1 over n, this effect of propagating a correlation and keeping it back is irrelevant. If the couplings are 1 over square root of n, you propagate a very weak correlation among all your neighbors. Then you collect it back, and you feel yourself. Okay? And so these are a very important point to understand, that even in a system, a mean field system where correlation goes to 0, because correlation goes to 0 like 1 over square root of n, 1 over square root of n is much slower than 1 over n, and so you have to be careful. And this is why you can build in these fully connected models very non-trivial correlation leading to many states. So this equation will have much more solutions than these equations because of this Gonzague reaction term. Now, the problem is that, okay, we are very happy, we derive self-consistency equation for our magnetization. So in principle, we can find this, what I will call from now on TAP, TAP states, because are the states defined by the magnetization that solves the TAP equation. Okay, maybe I'm not the right one, because in principle you can solve this equation even in a model that doesn't satisfy the hypothesis by which you derive it. So you can take a three-dimensional model and try to solve this equation. It will be useless. You find maybe not very interesting thing, but you can do, and you are looking for the TAP states, which are maybe not the right pure states of that model. This is an approximation. The problem is that, okay, I would like to to solve this equation, but suppose that I do it, I don't have any idea about the free energy these states corresponds to, because I just wrote a self-consistency equation for magnetization, but there is no free energy written on the blackboard, and the weights of my states, I expect it to be proportional to exponential of minus beta n the free energy of the states. So if I'm not able, so let me say this is the full free energy computed on the magnetization corresponding to that state. So I need to compute a free energy, which is still not on the blackboard. So now what we will do next is to compute the free energy. Computing the exact free energy is obviously very difficult. So what we are going to do is to compute a high temperature expansion to the free energy, which has also the nice property to have many minima, and each minima corresponds to this, the magnetization solving this equation. So we are going to build a high temperature expansion such that the second order of that high temperature expansion for the free energy do corresponds to a function which have the minima exactly on the magnetization solving this equation. This is not the true canonical free energy, because the true canonical free energy is convex, okay? These are high temperature expansion to the free energy, which is somehow is better for counting metastable states, because the canonical free energy is always dominated by the low-lying free energy states, but we are interested in counting them all, even the metastable states of a higher free energy, okay? So just to make you the usual Curie-Weiss example, if you take the Curie-Weiss in a field, the free energy that you want to compute is this one, because we are interested in the two minima. But if you do canonical computation, what you get is this one, with just one minima, and you lose the other metastable state. But you are interested in that, because if the metastable state becomes many, many, you cannot lose them. Because if you lose them, then you don't understand what the dynamics starting from here do. Because if you let the system relax from here, it reaches the metastable states. And to leave the metastable states, it takes a very large time. If you are interested in understanding what happened on human time scales, because we want to see what happened in hours, not in the life of the universe, you need to count these states. And so doing the standard canonical computation, you will lose it, and you get only this. So it's much better to have an approximated free energy, which has new minima. Hopefully, these new minima, we hope they are meaningful. And solving the TAP equation is already a good point to start being meaningful, at least in the fully connected model. So even if it's still before noon, I think we can stop now. We do 5 minutes stop, and then we'll try to derive the high temperature free energy expansion. Okay, so an announcement. Erika just told me that we are not going to do the picture after the lecture. So we are going to do it next week, because Matteo is not here now, and since the organizer will be not very nice to have the picture without the organizer. So you are free after the lecture. Okay, so let's concentrate for the 4 hours in a row. But now I will mainly follow Francesco Zamponi lecture notes from page 12. So if you miss some computation, you will find it written in his lecture notes. So our aim now is always for the usual Hamiltonian I have already written several times now. I want to find a high temperature expansion to the free energy. High temperature or weak coupling expansion is the same. Essentially, you want to have beta J very small, okay? And so this holds both for mean field models, where J is smaller. You have to just keep some terms. It holds at high temperature, where beta is smaller. And so either high temperature or weak coupling with expansion. So the in the notes, the notation is that of a paper by George Diedidia in 91, but actually this expansion was proposed by Plefka in 82. But the notation that we are going to use is bad, because Plefka essentially did the expansion up to the second order. And so in order to go on, George Diedidia did arrive up to the fourth order, if I remember correctly. They introduce a better notation that we are going to use. And so the notation that we use is in the George Diedidia paper in 91. Okay. So we start from the free energy in presence of an external field. So again, we do the same trick as before. We take the free energy, we put an external field in order to force to have exactly the magnetization that we want on each spin, and then we try to do we try to understand how much is the free energy fixing the magnetization. So the weight, the Gibbs weight among configuration that have that specified magnetization. Okay. And in order to simplify the notation, we introduce this function A, which depends on the temperature, but mainly on the magnetization. And this equal to minus beta F of the magnetization, okay? So we are trying to expand this F at fixed magnetization. So it's a high temperature expansion at fixed magnetization. And then we introduce the lambda I, which depends also on beta. We write it explicitly, which is defined as the inverse temperature times the external field that we add in order to fix the magnetization. So this, with this new formalism, this is the log of the sum over all the spins of exponential of minus beta, the Hamiltonian, which depends on the spins, plus the sum over I, lambda I, beta, SI minus MI. Okay? This is just, you can take the definition of gamma, because essentially we are expanding gamma, but we want to obtain a result where gamma is not the convex function, but thanks to the high temperature expansion, we obtain a new expression which is non-convex, okay? And here we have to fix this external field such that the magnetization is equal to M, so such that the average over this measure of SI minus MI is equal to zero. So the average of SI is equal to MI. I write this way because writing this way, you realize that essentially lambda is related to the derivative of this function with respect to MI. So from this, you can realize that lambda I beta is equal to minus the derivative with respect to MI indeed, if you take the derivative with respect to MI, you get essentially the this term down, and so you get lambda I of beta. Okay. So once you know the function A, you can understand also what are the parameters lambda that are inducing exactly the right magnetization that you want. Now, in order to do the computation faster, you have to introduce an observable U, which depends on the spins, which is defined this way, is the Hamiltonian, which depends on the spins, minus the average value overall on this measure. So the average, all the average values are carried on the measure in presence of the external fields, minus the sum over I, the derivative of lambda I of beta with respect to beta, times Si minus Mi. Okay, so this is defined. Why we introduce this observable? Because it has nice feature, and essentially is related to the derivative of any observable to beta, that, which is what we need, because we want to expand this in beta. So obviously, we have to take derivatives of beta, and we want to make the computation as simple as possible. This function u has this nice property, which is the average value of u is 0. This is pretty obvious, because the average value of h cancels the average value of h. And the average value of si minus mi is equal to 0 for any I. And so the average value of u is 0. But what is more important for our purpose is that if you take the derivative of any average value, or the average value of any observable with respect to beta, what you get, let me write here the expectation, so is simpler to show it. So the expectation that we are using is this, so the sum over sigma exponential of minus beta h plus the sum of I lambda I Si minus Mi, okay, divided by the sum over S okay, so this is the measure that we are using. So when you take the derivative with respect to beta, what happened, when you take the derivative of the numerator, you get a minus h down. And so the first term is minus o h. And you also get this term, the derivative of lambda with respect to beta. So you have one more term, which is plus the average value of o times the derivative of lambda okay, so these are the derivative of the numerator. And then when you take the derivative of the denominator, what you get is the average value. No, and the derivative of the numerator is zero, because what you get are the connected parts. You get the connected parts, so you get plus O H, and the connected part of this is zero, because the average value of Si minus Mi is zero. Okay? And you realize that all this expression, and finally you have one more term, which is the explicit derivative of the observable with respect to beta. So you have one more term, which is this. Okay? Now all this you realize is minus O times U. Because you see, O times H, average of O times average of H, and average of O times this term. Sorry, here there is one summation over I miss. Okay? So what we understand is that the derivative of any observable with respect to beta is just the average of the derivative of the observable minus the observable time u. And this is why we introduce this observable u, because it's the operator that you need to compute in order to take the derivative with respect to beta. As an example, which will be useful, if you compute the derivative of a fixed number, which is the magnetization with respect to beta, this is zero, because the magnetization is a fixed number. We are taking a high temporal expansion, a fixed magnetization, but the magnetization is also the average value of sigma I. And so if you use the formula we just derived, we can compute this with capital O being SI. And so this turns out to be equal to minus SI minus MI times U. Okay? Sorry, I missed one. No, indeed. You are perfectly right. I jump one. So I first need to write SI times U. Now you realize that the average value of U is zero, so I can add MI times the average value of U, because this is zero. And so finally you get minus the average value of U times SI minus MI. But since you started from zero, you just realize that this particular average value, so u, when you multiply by si minus mi, is zero. These are useful relations now that we do the expansion we are going to use to make the computation easier. Okay, so now we can really start doing derivatives. So we can, for example, take the first derivative of A with respect to beta. And if you take, I just erase this, but okay. This essentially taking the derivative of the numerator. So it's like the average value of minus h, which is when you take the derivative with respect to beta, you get minus h, plus the sum over I of the derivative of lambda I of beta with respect to beta, si minus mi. And thanks to the fact that the average value of si minus mi is zero, this is nothing but minus the average value of h. Here I'm not, at the end I will be interested in doing a Taylor expansion in beta equals zero, but for the moment I'm just taking derivative at any value of beta, so this expression is valid at any value of beta. Then eventually I will compute each term in beta equals zero because I'm interested in a high temporal expansion. And if you compute the second derivative, well, this is nothing but the first derivative of the first derivative. So you want to do the first derivative of h. And for the first derivative of h, you again use this expression. And using this expression, what you get is that, okay, the Hamiltonian doesn't depend explicitly on the temperature, so this is zero. You just get this. And so you get the average value of h times u. And the average value of h times u, you realize that is equal to the following. Let me add zero zeros. So I can add one term, which is the average value of h times the average value of u, because the average value of u we know is zero. Minus. I want to reconstruct this. And then I add more zeros. Minus the sum over I times the average value of SI minus MI, which again is zero. So I'm adding zeros, and what I get finally is that this can be written as u square. Because you take h, average value of h, and all these terms, and you reconstruct u. Okay? And so the second derivative of a, let me write it here, is u square. This is why they introduced this u operator, which is very, very comfortable. Yes? So you mean?
And during this formula, I don't see this. Okay,
because the.
I don't see, for example, average of dH over.
You're right. No, but now I'm worried that the average value of H, because this average is made at any temperature. And so the average value of the energy does depend on the temperature. Sorry, just use this. So when I take the derivative of the average value of h with respect to beta, here you have the derivative of h with respect to beta, which is zero, because the observable h doesn't have beta inside. And so you just have this term. Yes. So it's true. The average value of h depends on beta by this expression, but h itself doesn't depend on beta. So the first term is zero, and you have only the second term. And then you add the zeros, and you reconstruct u square. And you can go on. For example, I can write for you the third order term. I don't want to spend too much time in doing computation because I'm interested more in reaching the final result, but if you do a similar computation, you realize that the third order term is minus the average value of u to the cube. Okay? So you see that all these derivatives are pretty simple expression. And the only other things that you need. So you remember that in u, we also have derivatives of lambda with respect to beta. So as long as you take the average of the lowest moment of u, you don't need it. You just need the derivative of lambda with respect to beta in beta equals zero. But in principle, if you want to go on with this expansion, you will need to compute even higher order derivatives of lambda, which is the external field that you put on in order to enforce the local magnetization with respect to beta square, beta cube. So in general, starting from this expression that I didn't cancel in purpose, you can do any n derivative of lambda beta with respect to beta n times, but just taking minus the derivative with respect to mi of the derivative, the nth derivative of a with respect to beta n times. So while you compute all these terms, by taking these terms and then deriving with respect to mi, you get the derivatives of lambda. But for our purpose, essentially, we just need the first one. So the first one corresponds to take change in sign the derivative of h. And we are interested in computing these derivatives in beta equals 0. And so, for example, if you're interested in the first one, so d lambda I beta in d beta in beta equals 0 is just the derivative with respect to mi of the Hamiltonian, the average value of the Hamiltonian computed by 0, I mean computed with beta equals 0. Okay? And so this, you will see, is pretty simple because for beta equals 0, you can compute easily the average value of the Hamiltonian because the measure is the one with beta equals 0, so completely uncoupled spins, I will show you. And so these average values are simple, so you can take the derivative very, very, very simply. And you can also compute the second derivative by taking the derivative of u squared computed with beta equals 0. So, but we just need the first one. Okay? So these are essentially the terms of this expansion. And now let's make a concrete example for this Hamiltonian, and let's compute these terms just to see what are the first terms of this high temperature expansion. So let's compute, for example, the zero order term. The zero order term, so A0 of the magnetization, this is the free energy of a non-interacting spins, because beta enters in front of the Hamiltonian, and so you have non-interacting spins. And you can compute in different ways, because this still depends on the derivative of this parameter that enters in the definition of it depends on these parameters that enter the definition of a naught. So let's write it explicitly. This is the log of the sum over all the spins of exponential of the sum over I lambda I computed at beta equals 0 Si minus mi. Okay? And you see that even if there is no interaction, there is no Hamiltonian anymore, the magnetization are non-zero because you are forcing them to be non-zero. So you have a set of non-interacting spins, each one having its own magnetization because you are putting the right external field. Now you can proceed in two ways. You can derive the explicit expression for the external field that would make an isolated spin have magnetization mi, which is very simple and is satisfy if you take the derivative. You can compute, for example, Si minus mi equal to 0, taking the derivative, and you realize that the magnetization is given by the hyperbolic tangent of the field, which is exactly what you will expect. Or even more simply, you can think of this as the log of the partition function of n non-interacting spins, each one having its own magnetization, and you should already know the answer because this is the you only have the entropy term. There is no interaction. Each spin is isolated, and so what you get is the usual entropy term that you have already seen in the Q-revised model, but where each spin has a different magnetization. And so the final result is just the entropy term, 1 plus mi half log 1 plus mi half plus 1 minus mi half log 1 minus mi half. Okay? So you can do it two ways. So either you take this expression for lambda I, you plug it there, and you take really the sum, or you, much easier, you recognize that what you are computing is the partition function of n non-interacting spins, so it's the product of the partition function, and the partition function of a spin taking the value plus with probability 1 plus mi half, and value minus with probability 1 minus mi half is this one, okay?
I have two questions.
Yes. You're right, but is, yes, because we want to reconstruct this. So here you have to put an average value of u.
Okay. And then
no, sorry, let's put it here, because you want to reconstruct. So this term is u times si minus mi, such that you reconstruct exactly u squared. Yes. Yes, you take the derivative with respect to mi of this function.
So lambda I zero, if you, in the way we have defined it, lambda I beta is zero. I mean, it's beta times bi. No, the very first time you have defined lambda I beta, you have defined it as beta times bi.
Beta
times bi.
Yes, exactly. So this says that if you want to enforce in a spin which is isolated a non-zero magnetization, you need a non-zero field.
These
are isolated spins, so essentially the magnetization of each spin is the hyperbolic tangent of the field you are putting on.
No, but that's okay. But I have a problem with this definition. I mean,
No, this is why we introduced this function, because if I call this beta h, I'm expanding around beta equals zero, I need formally an infinite field.
Okay.
But since the true field that enters the measure is beta times h, it's much better to call lambda beta times h, because they will always enter coupled, and I need a finite value of lambda, which formally will correspond to an infinite value of h, but makes no sense because you are taking the beta equal to zero limit.
Okay.
So essentially, in this expansion, we are happy because the zero order term is providing the entropy. So non-interacting spins, when you compute the partition function, you just get the entropy. Okay? Now we compute the first order term, and the first order term of the derivative is minus the average value of h. And so the first order derivative computed in zero, so d beta computed in beta equals zero, you get minus the average value of h on zero. Remember that for beta equals zero, the measure is really factorized. You see, now we are really allowed to do the computation on a factorized measure because for beta equals zero, spins are independent. And so when you take the Hamiltonian, which is this one, and you take the average over factorized spins, as before, you just have to replace s with m. And so what you get is the sum over I and j, j I j, m I, m j, plus the sum over I, h I, m I. Okay? So I'm just taking the Hamiltonian and substituting. And from this, we get, for example, the first derivative of lambda that we need for the next order terms. And so, for example, if you want to compute this object, you just need to take the derivative of this expression with respect to mi, and so you get an explicit expression for the derivative of lambda with respect to beta, which is what enters in the average value of u. So in computing u square, you will need this, okay? So now, let me, yes. Mm. So let me skip some details in the computation and I'm writing the the final result. Otherwise, let me just derive the mean value of u at b equals zero, because that is the quantity that we'll find also in the next. So when you compute the derivative of lambda I with respect to beta once at beta equals zero, you have to take the derivative of this expression with respect to mi, change in sign, change in sign, yes, because there is a minus here. And so what you get is minus the sum over j, jij, mj, minus hi. Okay? And so now with this expression and this expression, you can compute what we call u naught, which is the average value of u at beta equals zero. And let me just keep the algebra. We have everything because we have the Hamiltonian, the average value of the Hamiltonian at beta equals zero, we have it. Then we have the Hamiltonian, which is written here. And we have the first derivative of lambda with respect to beta, which is written here. You put everything together, and what you get is a nice expression, which is, let's do it without the one half, sum over I smaller than j, jij, si minus mi, sj minus mj, okay? Indeed, it's very easy to realize that the average value of this observable is zero, because these are a connected correlation function. Okay, you go on and you compute terms, and the final result that you get is the following. So let me go to the final result that you can find written here up to the third order term, and in the paper by George Yedida up to the fourth order term, if I remember correctly, is the following. Minus beta f of m is, the first term is this entropic part, so minus sum over I of 1 plus mi half log 1 plus mi half plus 1 minus mi half log 1 minus mi half. Obviously, this term changes if you change the nature of the spins. This is for easing spins. If you take spherical spins, you will have a different entropic term. But you always have at a zero order term the entropic part of uncorrelated variables. Very easy to compute. Okay? Then the first term is plus beta, because it's an expansion in beta. So it's beta times the first derivative. And the first derivative, we have it here, is this. Okay? So it's beta times the sum over I smaller than j, jij, mi, mj, plus beta sum over I of hi, mi. So you see the first order term is the energy in the mean field approximation. You see, is the energy where you substitute the spin variables by their mean values, okay? So entropic part, energetic part. And this would be the naive mean field approximation. I will show you that taking the derivative of this, you get the naive mean field approximation. And then you have the second order term that actually provides you the Onsager reaction term. And if you remember, it's not written here, but the second derivative of A was the average value of U squared. So if you now compute this at beta equals zero, you just have to take that expression this, you have to square it and take the average by putting all sigma equal to m. If you do this and you manipulate a little bit the expression, what you get is something like beta squared half the sum over I smaller than j, j i j square, this is a second order term, 1 minus m I square, 1 minus m j square. I leave you as an exercise to do this. So take this expression, take the square, and then take the average, and you get this. Okay, and then there are higher order terms. I don't want to write them, but just to say that there is a term where you have j a j cube to the term beta cube. You have something like this, and terms where you have also j a j, j j k, and j k I. Okay, you have these two types of terms at the cubic term. You write explicit expression in the lecture notes. Okay, so look at this expression. So first of all, we are very happy because we have an expansion where we are able to give a meaning to each term, essentially. And especially the first order term and also the second order term. And I will show you now that taking derivatives of this expression, we get back either Naïman field or TAPA equation. And of this also, we are also very happy because we're exactly looking for a free energy, eventually an approximated free energy, which had the local minima exactly on the magnetization that corresponds to solution of TAPA equation, okay? And so hopefully using this free energy for also weighting those minima can be meaningful, because we are looking for a weight to assign to solution to TAPA equation. So we have the magnetization, when we are looking for the free energy to assign a weight. This is a good candidate, because at least has local minima exactly on the points that solve the TAPA equation. So let's show that the derivative of this expression provides back the TAPA equation and the Naïman field equation, depending on how many terms you take. So let's do the derivative of this equation. So let's do the derivative of minus beta f of m with respect to mi. So the derivative of the first term is the, well, you can do it explicitly, but I will write it for you. Is just the minus the inverse of the hyperbolic tangent, the arc hyperbolic tangent of mi. This is minus 1/2 log of 1 plus mi, 1 minus mi, okay? You can do the derivatives. Every time you have this expression, when you do the derivative with respect to the argument of the log, they cancel because you get 1 and minus 1. So the only important derivative are those with respect to the m which are outside, and so you get logarithm of 1 plus m minus the logarithm of 1 minus m, which is exactly that with the factor 1/2. And now, the interesting terms. You take the derivative of this guy, and you have a beta sum over j, jij, mj, plus beta hi. And you realize that if you set this to zero, you get the Naïman field equation. Because m is hyperbolic tangent of this, which is exactly the argument of the Naïman field equation. Now, let's do also the derivative of the second order term. The derivative of the second order term, you get plus, you see, if you derive with respect to mi, essentially mi, well, essentially you have a 2 that cancels these 2, and since we are taking the sum over the ordered pairs, you just have to count 1. So if you have ij, you never have ji, so it's enough to take one derivative out. So you get beta square sum over j jij square. Now this term is the one you derive, and so you get mi. And this term is the one you don't derive, and you get 1 minus mj square. And you realize that this is the Onsager reaction term that we wrote in the, there is a minus, because it's minus mi square, so you get a minus. And so this is the Onsager reaction term. So we realize that taking the second order expansion, we get back the TAP equation. If you want to, you can take also the third order expansion, but the third order term, it will be subleading. Why? Because even in the spinglass case, j of order 1 over square root of n, j square will be 1 over square root, 1 over n to the 3 halves. And the sum in front is always over j, over the neighbors. Okay? This case will be different because you have a double sum, so you have to work a little bit in order to realize that is subdominating. But at the end, you can convince yourself that essentially in this expansion, if you are interested in solving the Kurzweil model, is enough to keep the two lowest order terms. For spinglass SK model, you need to keep also this term. And the other terms, when they are interesting, in all the other cases, because you can run this expansion on any model, even a finite dimensional model. You see, these are very generic Hamiltonian. I can set the J such that they are mostly zero, and non-zero only among first neighbors. And the high temporal expansion is perfectly fine. So you can use this expansion either for finite dimensional models. This means that if a friend of you arrives and say, oh, you are very good in statistical mechanics, can you tell me something about this Hamiltonian and provide you some very nasty J's? You say, okay, I don't want to run a Monte Carlo code. That would be the right way of sampling the Gibbs measure. But let me start with something simpler. I take this expansion. I plug into the couplings and the fields that my friends brought me. And I look for the shape, for the minimum of this free energy. Maybe it's more difficult than running the Monte Carlo. Okay, but in principle, you can do it. Okay, so these are high temporal expansions that you can use in any situation. And let me do also one more interesting comment about this. but let me add something about this. I studied this approximation a few years ago because obviously you said that approximation is meaningful if using more and more terms you get better and better results. Unfortunately, this is not always the case. If you use this approximation, for example, at a very low temperature, this is a high temperature expansion, so nobody's telling you that at low temperature it will be good, you find that actually adding more terms, you do worst. And this typical thing of mean field approximation, you can prove they are good only in the high temperature regime. You can use them wherever, but keep in mind that using it in a region where you are not expected to use it, maybe it's better to keep few terms rather than increasing the number of terms. So increase the number of terms, either the approximation is very good or if the series is not converging, adding more terms is worse, because in a non-converging series, adding more terms, you make them even larger. Indeed, in this respect, it's worth looking back to the original Plefka paper of 1982, and what he did after deriving this expansion, actually, he derived up to this term because he was interested in showing that TAP equation can be obtained by high temporal expansion. He, obviously, being a series expansion, he asked, what is the radius of convergence? What are the temperature and magnetizations where I can expect that if I fix the magnetization to some values, and then I make the temperature lower and lower, what is the radius of convergence? Where should I stop? And so he tried to compute the radius of convergence of this series, which is non-trivial, but then you can realize that essentially the radius of convergence of this series is related to the radius of convergence of the series giving you the first derivative of H, and the first derivative of H, if you remember, is the Hamiltonian. So he managed to write a simpler series, and he realized this Plevka condition for convergence of the series, which is the following: the temperature must be larger than sum over I 1 minus mi square. So you fix the magnetization, and you try to do this high temperature expansion of the free energy at fixed magnetization. This Plevka condition is telling you, you are allowed to use that expansion only for temperature high enough. This for the SK model, okay? So when the couplings are zero mean, so average J is equal to zero, and is 1 over n, okay? What does it mean? If you look at the TAP equation, or the Naïmian field equation, for example, you always have one solution, which is easy to understand. What is the solution? All magnetization equal to zero. That is always a solution. Look at this. Zero equal to zero, zero, zero. Everything is zero. So all magnetization equal to zero, which is the paramagnetic state, is always a solution. But if you put m equal to zero here, you get one. And this say that temperature must be larger than one. And if you solve the SK model, we are not going to do it, but it's known that the critical temperature of the model is one. So what the Plevka condition says, you cannot use this expansion for computing the free energy of the paramagnetic phase below the critical temperature. If you do it, you get a wrong result, okay? And indeed, this is very important, because if you start looking for the solution of this TAP equation, unfortunately, you find that the paramagnetic solution is always very attractive. So you run any algorithm for trying to find the solution of this solution, because now you have a free energy, so you are happy. Say, okay, now I solve this equation, and every time I find a solution, I compute the free energy, so I know the weight, and so I can compute everything. Unfortunately, you run any algorithm for solving equation, nonlinear equation, or for minimizing a function, because you can either minimize in a function or solve in nonlinear equation at your will, and you find that the paramagnetic solution is very attractive. And so when you try to compute states in the SK model below the critical temperature, because above the critical temperature, the only solution is m equal to zero. You want to do it below critical temperature. You get very much attracted by this solution, but this solution is wrong. It doesn't satisfy the Plevka condition. So you are not allowed to use this free energy expansion on that solution. And so the number you get, the W alpha that you get, is wrong. Okay? So, one more comment before leaving for today. If you take this expansion, you see already at the third order terms that there are terms involving always the same link between I and J, and terms involving links that form loops, okay? And this will be true also at high order, as you would expect. So if you go to the fourth order, you will find a term which is Jij to the four, and terms with loops, okay? One nice thing of this expansion is that if you keep all the terms involving just one link, so you forget loops, you can run this expansion on any graph. Suppose that I run it on a random graph, on a tree. There are no loops. So each term involving a loop is zero, because at least one of the j is zero. So I cancel all the terms with loops. I keep all the terms with just jij to any power. I resum, and what I get is the beta free energy that we are going to study later in these lectures. So the beta free energy can be seen as the resummation of this series. This is very good because we know that the beta free energy is exact on random graphs or on trees, and having a power series that on loopless graph has an infinite number of terms that if you resum, you get the right result. Anyway, it's very good for this approximation. So on loopless graph, this is nothing but the high temporal expansion of the exact beta free energy, okay? And so this is also very good for this kind of approximation. Just a last comment about the application of this TAP free energy. So from now on, I will call this the TAP free energy. And those are the TAP equations. So the TAP equations are just the derivative of the TAP free energy. If you didn't read the Plefka paper, and maybe you derived by yourself, you can say, well, I want to check that, suppose that I'm not so good as Plefka in understanding what is the radius of convergence of this series. So I just keep the first three terms. But I understood that this solution must be minima of the tap free energy. So instead of, I can try to propose a way of discriminating good solution for non-good solution, looking whether the solution is a real minimum of the free energy. It may be a subtle point, it may be a maximum, okay? So suppose that I don't know the Plefka condition, and I do this in order to compute the Hessian. So the Hessian is the element ij is defined as the second derivative, is the second derivative of f with respect to mi mj. Okay, so if the point I just found is a good minimum, this matrix Hessian must be positive defined. And suppose that I do this computation, and I do the computation on a very simple point, which is the parametric fixed point, all magnetization equal to zero. So you take the second derivative, you set m equal to zero, and this expression for m equal to zero is pretty simple. It looks like t plus 1 over t, or beta plus 1 over beta, delta ij minus jij. So look what happened. You have a matrix. Compute the spectrum of this matrix is not hard, because this is a random Gaussian matrix. So his spectrum is a Wigner semicircular law, so the spectrum of this matrix is between 2 and minus 2, okay? Now, this is a diagonal matrix, so the eigenvalues are t plus 1 minus t. So the smallest eigenvalue, the first that may become negative, because you want to have all the eigenvalue positive, is taking minus 2 for the random matrix and t plus t. So the smallest eigenvalue is, so the smallest eigenvalue is minus 2 plus t plus 1 over t. You realize that this quantity, as a function of t, is always positive, touches 0 in 1, and is always positive. So what is telling you is that in t equal 1, which is the critical point, you have a zero mode in this free energy. So it's marginal. Indeed, it's not really a minimum of the free energy. But what you don't like is that below the critical temperature, the paramagnetic minimum, so the minimum in M equals zero, is again a minimum. So, sorry, the point M equals zero in the B, in the TAP free energy is again a minimum, while the Plevka condition is telling us that the free energy in M equals zero shouldn't, this free energy shouldn't be used. So what's happening, and so in this you have to be careful, you're using an approximation. That approximation looks like it have a nice minimum in N equals zero below the critical temperature, but you don't have to use that point. And so the Plevka condition is telling you this. And indeed, it's very simple. You can understand that you cannot use the paramagnetic fixed point below the critical temperature, because if you compute the entropy, and this is a model of discrete variables, the entropy must be positive, you realize that the entropy of the paramagnetic fixed point becomes negative slightly below the critical temperature. So clearly, the entropy of the paramagnetic solution becomes negative, which is unphysical. So clearly, below T equal 1 for the SK model, you don't have to take the M equals 0 solution. Unfortunately, it's very attractive. So then finding TAP solution for SK model is an open problem. So this is a new open problem. Find TAP states for SK below the critical temperature. Essentially, we still don't have a good algorithm. There are just a couple of works where people minimize this function at very low temperature, but at very low temperature is like minimizing the energy. So you are looking for the minimum of the energy. The problem is that you would like to compute really states in all the temporal range between 0 and 1. So this is still an open problem. It's very simple in stating because it's solved this equation, but it's very hard. And if you're interested, I can tell you why it's hard. Okay, for today is enough. Sorry for being late. Thanks.